helping to support here. So, so I would like to introduce my friend Paula Bialski and her research partner Götz Bachmann. They've been doing a lot of work in anonymity on the internet and how I know a lot about Paula's work. Since we met in 2006 or quite possibly probably before, has been researching peer-to-peer, how strangers trust one another through internet platforms, and what levels of anonymity that different platforms have in order to connect people, and how trust is built through these online interactions. So she and I have spent some time talking about this, and I suggested that she come in and talk about some of her research because I thought it would be interesting to all of you.
Cool.
So yeah, you guys come on up and present.
Thank you so much, Rachel. Wonderful. It's really wonderful to be here. This culminates a month and a half of my fieldwork here in the Bay Area. We're going to tell you a little bit about this project, about the anonymity project that has started in Germany, and it's just really about to begin formally. And Götz Bachmann, come over here, Götz Bachmann. He's standing in the corner. Götz Bachmann and myself are working at a place called the Digital Cultures Research Lab. I'm a sociologist and Götz is an anthropologist. We work with all sorts of people who qualitatively, so we don't do number crunching, who qualitatively look at digital cultures. So all sorts of aspects from computing histories to the philosophy of wires and cables, so all sorts of things, including anonymity. And Götz, as well as a few other people at the University of Bremen, at the University of Hamburg, at Luneburg University, where we are based, which is just south of Hamburg, we wrote together a large proposal last year that won a lot of funding from the VW Foundation in Germany to study anonymity and all sorts of facets of anonymity, not only how it's being reconfigured due to the digital, but also due to urbanity, due to mobility, to all sorts of postmodern questions. Götz will address this wonderful large project, and I'll tell you a little bit about what I've been doing in the field in the past month and a half. So take it away.
Hi.
I think you have to grab talk here.
Screen. Hello. Okay.
Yeah.
Hi. My name is Götz. Okay. My name is Götz, and yeah, I guess I'm gonna give you a little bit, like, say, like 10 minutes of the hard part, of the German part of this thing, because actually it was a very sweet lie that you said, we've been doing a lot of research on anonymity. We actually have been doing very little research yet on anonymity. This is a research project that will start in October. So what I'm gonna do is something that academics already hate a lot, and I guess maybe you even hate more. I'm gonna talk about a research project that hasn't happened yet, the conceptual thinking that we might think something will come out of, but maybe it's still interesting, the kind of framework that we are working in. So my personal interest in anonymity comes out of another research project. As Paula has said, we are ethnographers. Ethnographers are hanging around with people in different and strange places. I was hanging out in Japan 10 years ago, and I was researching a platform called Nico Nico Douga. Does anyone know this here? So, you know, like Nico Nico Douga, a very big video platform, the main competitor of YouTube in Japan, but works in several aspects fundamentally different to YouTube. And the most noticeable thing, how it works different, is that people write their comments on the video. Well, you could do that for a time in YouTube as well, but, okay. You could do that on YouTube as well, but on Nico Nico Douga, many, many people were writing very short and anonymous comments without any further pseudonymity or anything. People just left their traces, and that meant that these comments could merge in something which they called cookie. And cookie is an atmosphere, a collective atmosphere that arises when you are consuming something together. So instead of watching your video alone at home, it felt like as if you are watching the video just like you are in a very noisy rock concert. where lots of cheering would happen, lots of affirmation would happen, because interestingly, once you are in this form anonymous, people would all start to write very similar things. They would lose the need to always be very original or be confrontative, but instead they would develop all sorts of strange ways of collectively playing along with the video. And that is under the condition of anonymity. There's also all sorts of other practices that are happening on this platform, which are all can only happen when they are anonymous. One of them would be that people delete each other's tags. So that's a hard thing to do if you just have tagged something and I delete it. But they could do it because tagging was fully anonymous. There was no identity behind that. And this deletion games around tags made tags much more effective. Another thing was authorship. If you would be an author and put up a video, you would hope that people over time recognize your style and name you instead of you yourself saying, "This is Joe. I made this fantastic video of my children. Look how awesome I am." So people in Japan said, "These practices are different practices, whereas YouTube is a medium for the bullies. Nico Nico Douga was a medium for the bullied," because this was a lot about collective expression, and it's all on the condition of anonymity. So I fell in love with anonymity. I talked with a colleague, another anthropologist, Michi Knecht, and she's done research on totally different fields on gametonation, and she said also very interesting stuff happened around anonymity. And once you start thinking about it, you think like what a big and fundamental topic it is. It's really at the base of, now I'm getting a lot European, egalité, like liberté, égalité, and fraternité, like all these basic values of European culture, maybe Western culture, to my mind, they are deeply tied to anonymous practices. You know, like liberté, I don't have to explain in the time of Snowden, but also égalité, the possibility that you encounter each other without being notified as like pinned down as someone who is a woman or like whatever, different forms of encounter. And also fraternité, the possibility of forming forms of collectivities, they partially run on anonymity. So something important is at stake. And of course, you also know something important is at stake that's at the moment changing. It's changing majorly through ICT. It's changing through surveillance. It's changing through discourses of transparency, like an idea that transparency is a high value and maybe a more important value than anonymity. And we kind of had this feeling, hey, wait a minute. There's something deeply productive about anonymity that we gotta going to save. That's, I don't know like how much more shall I talk more about this, like unbaked eggs, because this is not empirical research. This is just a bunch of research that's kind of like philosophizing about anonymity. So tell me more about this or more empirical stuff?
More. Say what the other guys are doing in the project, maybe. The other guys are doing in the project. What is it? How long will the project last?
Okay, the project will last for 3 years. It's going to consist of 4 ethnographic projects, all of them producing people like Paula and myself hanging around with people. One will look at police work, especially in Northern Ireland and in Germany, and like and how anonymity is how anonymity is playing out there. One project will look at gamete donation, sperm donation, egg donation, and the big consequences that anonymous practices, anonymous infrastructures, anonymity regulations have in this area, especially. I mean, like this is a very intimate area, obviously, because this is about later forms of, you know, who your father is, who your mother is. So that's the second project. The third project will look at how social media is like, especially in the early moments of building new social media apps, how designers, how information architects, how marketeers, how developers negotiate how and where, what parts of the platform is in what kind of way anonymous, and how that is then marketed or kept secret. Okay, so this, we believe, is a very, very important decision that you have to make early on when you create any form of social media, and we are interested in the kind of intelligence that is almost like playing out around anonymity. We want to learn how people think about anonymity in this respect. A fourth project looks at all the forms of anonymity that prize out of your purse, and all the cards that are in there, from your health card, it's, I guess, like a German thing, until to your health insurance card, to your credit cards, and all sorts of other customer cards. And what is at stake here? Anonymity, and we'll follow that up into the databases. And the fifth project will have a lot of artists, some of them media artists, some of them other artists, reacting to these kind of like ethnographic research with their own work, so that we have another level of and like conceptual thinking coming out of art in this project. Our thinking about anonymity is that it's always partial. You know, there's no full anonymity ever. That is always some tension of perceived and real, I mean, like whatever real is, that is never kind of like universal, that is always, you're always anonymous in a certain direction. Someone has access, someone has not. It has a duration. It's very important how long you know you will stay anonymous. Will you be anonymous forever, or will that be only for the next month? All these questions we have to find out in detail. We will research this in a framework where we always look at practices. Practices are like what people do again and again and again. Technology and infrastructures, and the whole set of legal but also moral forms of regulation, we think that in all these cases will be at stake and will be negotiated by all these actors. And maybe one last thing, because we believe that on a very fundamental way, anonymity will pose this big question. One of the big questions is, like, how do you run reciprocity when you have anonymity? Like, how do you give back? It's a very interesting, like, in anonymous spheres, you often give something, and who gives it back? If you donate your semen, who gives it back? You know, like, that kind of openness of not being able to give back is for anthropologists and ethnographers very interesting, because we believe that there is something called the gift economy, and that always has some underlying needs of reciprocity, and they are undermined, and that's interesting to us. The second thing is, of course, the question of personhood, because anthropologists don't take for granted that you, as you, I don't know, what's your name? Lewis, that Lewis is Lewis is Lewis, and that's what it is, and we all know that Lewis is Lewis, and all fine. We think that Lewis is many, many, many things, and all sorts of elements, and anonymity cuts through Lewis in many. So Lewis is maybe, for a database, only a name, and there is a piece of meat, and there is like all sorts of other things. So these kind of like, how does personhood reemerge under conditions of anonymity is something that we are very interested in. And the last point is, of course, and maybe very important for you, accountability. How do you hold people accountable for their actions, which is another very, very fundamental question, once you enable this important cultural technique of modernity, which we call anonymity. This is what we want to research and which we haven't yet answered, but Paula has some answers already.
Exactly. Thanks, Gotz. And another thing is that if you're interested in following the stuff that we'll be doing in the next few years, there is a website and a blog that's called reconfiguringanonymity.net, and I'll put that up at the end of this presentation. So you guys got an overview of what we'll be doing, but what we did at the ground level right now is they kind of sent me as an ethnographer here to the Bay Area for a month and a half to do sort of, I don't call it a discourse analysis, but maybe a more of a mapping of the different discourses that are happening in the Bay Area, in the tech industry, around forms of anonymity, and really what is happening around anonymity in this space, among developers, among activists, around people who analyze data, among people such as yourselves who work in education. All sorts of aspects are very important, and anonymity is very important to all sorts of dimensions of people working in the tech industry, as you know, but a lot of times it's not thought about, or let's say it's thought about too much, or people feel hopeless or don't know what's happening in general in the discourse. So I just came here and I said, well, what is the state of the art right now? What is happening right now? And my methods are pretty simple. I just go and chat to people, really. And I conduct interviews between 1 hour to 3 hours where I sit and chat and just really listen to people's stories of what they're trying to do in this space. Really, what are they trying to develop? If someone is developing an app that's more of a quantified self-type app. How does he deal with people's identity in this sense? He's collecting data, she's collecting data. What are they doing with this data and how does it work? Or how does it work for a browser? How does someone browse through and the web, and how do they browse anonymously? Is that possible? What kind of features are being enabler in different browsers? What if someone's working in mapping and collecting data and they need more data, but they also have this struggle, they don't know what to do? So there's all sorts of aspects. And I spoke to everyone from activists, as I said, to people in larger corporations, to a guy developing an app, to a woman who's active in the identity space. So all sorts of people. I did about 20 interviews and a few roundtable discussions with larger companies or larger groups. So I'm not saying in any way I'm an expert, but I just wanted to share with you some of the stories and some of the problems I see in this space. Yeah. So I'm just going to go through it, and I don't actually know how much you guys know. Also, a bit of maybe contextual, theoretical background about anonymity. So I'll take also some quotes from some of the my favorite quotes from some of the books that I've read around this topic. So there's a philosopher named Panesse, who's, I believe, in New York, and she says anonymity is a matter of being unable to associate particular pieces of information with specific persons. So let's remember that anonymity is relational. I know that in the field, when I was talking about anonymity, a lot of people started talking about privacy. And that is very much related, but privacy is kind of this more general thing. Anonymity has really a lot to do with relationality. Who am I talking to, right? Privacy is just everyone, that I don't want data going out there to random unknown person X, but it's not really relational. When we start a relation, that's where anonymity starts in some ways to develop. And I'll give you guys also a list of some readings if you guys are interested in catching up. So I'll give you where this quote came from later too. Many of you have read Lawrence Lessig's work on code. The second edition came out in 2006, but already in the late 90s, he was saying code on the internet is a regulator and the people live life on the internet subject to that regulation. So the ways that we want to engage with anonymity is also regulated by the code that we are then part of. We become code, right? We have become encoded online, and that code has a life of itself that regulates our forms of practice. We can't practice certain things because we become part of certain regulations as we become code online, which I've noticed in a lot of discussions. And also, Panesse says that she suspects that many forms of anonymity are spontaneous, unintentional, or even avoidable. So this has also came out with a lot of the stories that of the people that I was talking to. They said anonymity is not about the mega crypto guy who's trying to like hack something huge, or it doesn't always have to do with something big, something massive, or an uprising or a political situation. This is a long quote, but I'll read it from a software engineer who I interviewed here in San Francisco, and he said, people are frightened and intimidated and experience various forms of social pressures. There are all sorts of threats they're exposed to or they think they're exposed to. For example, they feel that there is a certain role they have to play or a certain way they have to act. These are all personal threats, and anonymity is about acting a little more free from these things. So he says that we have real micro pressures in our society too, and people come up with these examples of totalitarian regimes and say that we are not like them. We have free society. Anonymity is just needed to fight regimes like in the Arab Spring or in China, etc. And he says, then you go and talk to these same people and see that they do have their own concerns and spontaneous moments they choose to be private. So this spontaneity in anonymity is really important too. We forget that just as we do offline, we make certain cuts, we put on different hats, we say certain things, we conceal our names sometimes, we conceal where we're going to whomever, or to our mom, or somebody, or to our teacher, or to whoever it is that we're talking to. So these moments of how we engage in anonymity tend to be very spontaneous and not something deliberate that we deliberately need to log into something and crack something and be anonymous, right? So this is also worth taking into account, that anonymity is a spontaneous thing. And trusted systems, as Lessig said, depend on data. They depend on the ability to know how people use the property that is being protected. So this is also a thing that the way we are anonymous, I noticed this by a lot of stories, that people are saying, really, the way we're anonymous, how we can engage in anonymity, is now not our choice. We can't take off a hat and put it on. A lot of the time, other people have our data. Other people know, are tracking what we are doing online, and we don't have that availability to take away that idea, to delete what we've done before, to unlink the links that are happening that someone else can make, right? So this trusted systems depend on this data, but they're also collecting it, and they're also controlling, I think, the forms of anonymity that we can engage in. And Leslie, I'll say all of the good that comes from monitoring could be achieved while protecting privacy. It may take a bit more coding to build in routines and breaking traceability. It may take more planning to ensure that privacy is protected. But if those rules are embedded up front, the cost would not be terribly high. It is far cheaper to architect privacy protection now rather than profit for them later. And remember, Leslie also wrote this in the late 90s, even though this was the second edition. So he's saying, well, this is easy, guys. This was how many years ago, right? And this is the problem with I noticed in this space, and you guys can later correct me if I'm wrong, is that it's nothing really, I mean, stuff is being done, but there's a small, not much of a discourse or an idea that things are hopeless. And a lot of people in the field that I've talked to said, this is really hopeless. And this was actually something quite sad that came out of the field of the stories that I've heard. They said, I don't know how to innovate in this field that really makes a mass amount of people use these technologies, right? Something that Lessig hoped that could just happen in the next years back in the 1990s, right? So I'm going to skip over this. And another technologist said that this was the problem. So these are a few problems of why there's this hopelessness, there's a feeling of this challenge in this space. One technologist said the computer was fundamentally designed down to its CPU architecture as a tool for espionage. People are not aware of this and not aware that de facto espionage pervades daily life. There must be a deeper awareness that understanding cryptography is fundamentally a tradecraft of computer literacy. So one technology said, yeah, computer literacy and saying we know how to use the computer doesn't equate to we know how to encrypt our systems, we know how to protect ourselves. That's not, we know how to use Facebook, we know how to browse, he says, and that's it for everyone. They don't understand that to understand the computer is to understand how to encrypt. So that's one problem, that this lack of the link, this awareness that I want to know more about the computer, I want to understand how to use it. It's not only about typing, it's not about browsing around in Facebook, it's about encryption. That's literacy. I'm going to skip over this as well. Another technologist said that this is another problem. Technologists are not interested in developing these simple tools for people to use. Simple tools to help user anonymity are relatively easy to create, but the engineers around me are trying to work on difficult cryptography systems and trying to impress one another with more abstract solutions that might not be directly applicable. So this is also somebody who's a really quite advanced software engineer. He is at a large university and he's actually developing encryption systems, but he just says, well, it's kind of a race to make the coolest and the most abstract. It's not about developing tools for mass amount of users to use. So that's also something that's not there in the space. And another huge issue in this anonymity space is that I found is around data and data collection. And one data analyst said that as somebody who works in transport, we want so much more data than is available today. Moreover, there's already a lot of data in our company, but obtaining it is a constant battle between the product developers and privacy team. So developers who are driven on data do not have a sensitivity to users' anonymity. We want their data in order to create better tools. And same thing for this guy, he said, convenience trumps over privacy practices in the current climate. On a daily basis, users are not willing to take the time to engage in practices that offer more protection because it might be costly and slow. What we have to develop for the users are tools that are automatic and don't cost us anything. So as somebody who develops, creating fast and efficient ways help the user be anonymous is really difficult. So here are some difficulties that I really noticed with talking to these guys. There's a lot about technologists just don't have basically the drive to invent just very easy tools for people to use. Also, people are not aware that in order to use the computer and in order to be literate in the computer, we have to take the time to actually engage in these kind of a little bit more arduous power practices, but teach ourselves how to encrypt. And also this idea about speed and convenience, that's also very much linked to it. So I noticed when I was talking to a lot of these people that's what I wanted to summarize. I think maybe I would like to open the field to you guys is really this feeling that we don't really know what to do. There's no money in this. There's no ways of preserving our our ways of being anonymous. Slowly some stuff is coming out, but how much is this going to be in a space? And I also noticed that this is a lot happens in the open source space, that a lot of tools like these are being developed there, and that's really great, but how much is that can be sustained and how can it be scaled? That's the question that a lot of these people were asking. So some of the tools, of course, are Tor browsing, proof of work tokens, contextual identity. You guys know what Tor browsing is? I think a lot of you guys know it. I don't want to, maybe I could run through some of these things. You guys probably know them. But some of these are just some of the stuff that people, when I asked, well, what are some of the ways that people can engage in anonymity? They said, these are some of the forms of Tor browsing, or if Tor browsing is blocked, maybe something like a proof of work token can work. And a proof of work token is something that it's like a CAPTCHA, but a little bit harder, like you have to read a page of a certain book, and it takes a lot longer than, I don't know, 15, 20 minutes, and then you do that, and then you prove that you have that, and you have that proof of work token for a while until, let's say, you've reached something, and you vandalize something, and then you have to go again and do the proof of work token. So you are identified with someone who is trusted because you've done the work to be trusted. I think that's what how I understand it. So that's one, contextual identity. That's also how this works on some browsers, of how browsers are trying to develop ways of browsing that can be contextual. That it's not that I'm browsing as Paula all the time, but this also has to do with pseudonymity, certain browser add-ons, etc. And there could be more. Do you guys know others? Other forms? Any thoughts on? No? I'm just wondering if anyone knows. Sorry? Going to the library? Yeah, going to the library and using a computer there. Yeah, that's true. Tails. Yep. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, I forgot to put that on there. This is just some, PGP keys is a good example too. But I was just wondering, maybe I could open the floor to you guys, because I just wanted to take 15 minutes to present that. I have other, of course, stories, and I'm really open to some questions, but the I would really be interested in hearing your stories of where you see this space may be problematic or not, or really how do you guys at Wikipedia enable user anonymity or think maybe around user anonymity as well? Any thoughts? Any questions? Yes.
Hi.
It's a bit quiet.
1, 2, can you, is it working? Maybe, I can shout. Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Sorry. I'm interested in this idea that you said before, that anonymity is actually relative. So for instance, in the context of our technical community, I wonder if someone is anonymous or not, because it's a consistent username. So I don't know really who's the person. But even if I would have full name, telephone number, and address, doesn't matter because that person is living somewhere else and we are not going to meet. And it's not even the point because we are discussing some software change, for instance. So in the case of a username, and we have plenty of usernames, I mean, actually in Wikipedia it's more about usernames than anything apart from anonymous, like as in not even a username contributions. Mm-hmm. Is it really anonymous or not? I don't know who's the person. I don't know where it lives in the planet. But it's a consistent identity that comes and comes back and keeps a discussion, and keeps a contribution. So at the end, I don't know that person, but I know that person because we've been working together for 2 years. So is that anonymous or not anonymous?
Yeah, that's a great question. Götz, do you want to come up here? Götz, you have to come up here to serve the camera.
Yeah, sorry.
Always forget the space.
The people at home.
Yeah, it's like I try to be anonymous. okay. I think I would first drop that question whether something is anonymous or not anonymous, because I think that doesn't make sense in this general way. At least that's how I am currently thinking about it when I think about it. And this is like, as I say, like the beginning of a research project, and the point about research project is that my thinking will change many, many more times. But at the moment, I think the best way of conceptualizing is that you look for the cuts For example, the cut between your clear name and another name, or the cut between your clear name and flash, or the cut of the clear name on a certain statement, or your IP address. You make all these kind of cuts for certain people under certain circumstances, and you look for these moments of cuts. And it's not like full anonymity is never given. I mean, think of Alcoholics Anonymous. You go there, you show your face, you are there, you are like, in one way, absolutely non-anonymous, but you make certain cuts and you say that this is not relevant, just by a common consensus, and then you have a feeling actually this is anonymous. So it's this practice of cutting, and that's maybe also a slight difference to the discourse about privacy. We have, like, there is a hidden assumption. I don't know whether that's relevant to your question, but we have a hidden assumption in our research portfolio and hypothesis that privacy is not a good way of thinking about these questions, often because it's too clumsy. That's maybe a German perspective, because there's a huge privacy protection discourse in Germany. You're like, everyone wants to. And we think that behind this privacy thinking is always this kind of like, you could build a wall around your castle somehow and make like these walls and these fences, and that somehow would do in digital cultures. And of course that's ridiculous. We can't do this anymore. We can't, and you know, it's all about being public. So privacy discourses don't make sense anymore, or make sense but in other respects. Certain things surely should probably keep private, but I think anonymity gives us a more flexible way of thinking of it's almost like a the doctors who cut the
medical,
it's a more surgery, the technique of a surgeon, and not the technique of, I don't know what the other one that be.
Whichever.
So that's kind of like the idea how we want to conceptualize it. But this is just like a general framework. I cannot give the precise answers. I think that would have to come from you in a longer interview. How and where do you enable these cuts? For whom, when, for what duration, under what circumstances you say we're going to undo these cuts because you actually have been posting this or you've been doing that, and so on. So it's a complex set of rules that I've
cut. Yeah.
That's by the way, not our idea. That's the idea of Julie Panes, to give credit to where credit's due.
Yeah. Someone else had a question. Yeah.
So I'm going a little bit more general and not actually answering your question, and just giving some thoughts, because from my perspective, the issue, and it shows my bias and way I see things, but my perspective is that the issue comes down to what are the incentives for the people writing the software, right? And the incentives traditionally here, especially here being the area, is money making, period. Mm. Like, there is nothing else other than making money.
Yeah.
Ever. And that makes them make choices from the very beginning. They have a limited amount of time to do what they need to do to make their product and sell it. They're not going to care about something that doesn't help their bottom line and actually potentially even hurts their bottom line. Because ads are how you make money, and ads do better when they know all about the person. And that's the antithesis of anonymity. So maybe I am more in the camp of fatalist about this whole discussion, that it does take work from the user. The only people in the conversation that can be empowered are the user, but it's a tremendously uphill Sisyphean work effort. Yeah. So
That's really interesting, because I think it comes back to what I said, that I noticed also that the only really interesting work that's happening in this space is from the open source community, or people who are not in it for the money. I didn't notice that. And it also, another thing, just to give another little point to that, is that it's not only about the ad agencies, as you know, it's also anyone from who wants to develop one feature on their app that has something to help, I don't know, you walk your dog on a better route or something, right? It doesn't have to be that. That also gains, you gain data, and you, right, de-anonymize the user, or you identify the user in some way, and you link, and you don't make those, allow the people to make those cuts. So yeah, exactly. And it's, yeah, I'm also fatalist in some way after this month and a half here, sadly. Yeah, go ahead. Sorry, good to see you.
But maybe just to add one quick thing, if you think that money is to be made where demand is, I mean, at least, I mean, Germany is a pretty big market, and the whole country is obsessed about privacy. They call it privacy, but there's like 80 million people screaming for products that are not there. And they also, like, maybe they are there, it's more complicated, but I mean, like, it's not automatically given that there's no money to be made.
Yeah. Go ahead, sorry.
Oh, yeah. So this is sort of a philosophical question, I guess. I thought it was really interesting exploring the relationship between ideas of freedom or liberty and anonymity. I recently read something by David Graeber that looked at that relationship of having freedoms from a different perspective of actually acknowledging obligations. So to have a freedom of speech, for example, would mean that you live in an environment where people feel obliged to let somebody speak without some sort of violent recourse. Mm. So how does anonymity affect people's obligations to one another? And by extension, how does that affect the ability to have certain freedoms?
You want to take it? I
guess this is a wonderful question. This is the kind of question that we want to research. And again, I have to say the research only begins. But totally, our thinking comes a lot out of the same school, like David Graeber comes from, and this is also maybe one answer why the one-off product, the one-off wonderful but easy cryptographic product, is not going to cut it, because anonymity throws out problems, and these problems have to be solved very specifically. So anonymity has to be solved inside Wikipedia, and you have to find inside Wikipedia solutions where you make as much cuts where they are meaningful as possible without destroying the economy of obligations, for example, that drives a lot of user-driven platforms. That's not an easy thing to do. On the other hand, there's huge chances in gamut donation. Some other researcher called Monica Conrad, to credit her, has shown that people who have donated sperm, they sometimes then have the feeling that they have given something and now they're getting it back by the world. So there is it's actually quite a very pleasant, like, new form of connectedness to an anonymous, it could be everyone, and therefore I have a new ethical stance in the world. So these kind of like obligations produce all sorts of stances in the world, which are really interesting to follow up, and some of them are quite surprising. That's what we hope to find out.
Yeah. I'm just noting something that's happening in Wikipedia, and it's closely related to Dan's question. We definitely have all the tensions that you're describing with, you know, analytics versus privacy issues and everywhere. But one thing that really surprises me about what's happening on Wikipedia is that there are editors who want to strip each other's anonymity. And I'm not sure if you've seen this before, but basically it's just so that there's some kind of accountability for what's being written. So
editors who want to... what?
They want to strip each other's anonymity.
Strip?
And, yeah.
And strip other of anonymity.
Okay. It says, crude as, if you don't log in, then recorded as editing something from IP address.
Yeah. So you're just... Is that a question? You're just frustrated that this is, or this is a situation?
I would love to hear related stories.
Mm-hmm.
Would it be helpful to answer the question? So, I mean, you posed this initial question and none of us have quite actually answered it.
Yeah.
So I don't know how much background it would be, I think, to respond to this question may require some background. So let me give you what I think of as sort of the 60-second version, which is we enable anyone to edit the site anonymously, anonymously in quotes. However, that definition of anonymity actually posts your IP address as associated with that edit. And we also record a certain additional, so that is, the IP address is public, and we also record certain other characteristics, such as characteristics of your browser primarily, that people with, so anyone in the world can see the IP address, And then additionally, people with a certain amount of permissions can look at things like the browser fingerprint in order to fight spam, essentially, right? Some people consider the spam problem severe enough that they would like to essentially either block all such edits, or under some circumstances, we may block entire IP ranges, right? Like, an entire university may be blocked for vandalizing a rival university or something like that, right? Yeah. So that's sort of the state of the art. And the question is, should we be taking more, at least a question that is a recurring theme of discussion for us is, should we be taking more steps to protect those IP addresses? Should we be taking more steps to surface some of that fingerprinting information, perhaps through some sort of unique ID, in order to help more casual users fight spam? How do we strike that balance? Like, I think that's the more expansive version of the question that's just asked. And we don't have, I mean, I think we could spend all of the rest of your afternoon filling in details on that, but that's sort of the background.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And that's why we think it's so interesting to research. If you could give us a 60-second answer, I mean, like, then why do a 3-year research project about it? We would be very interested in this discussion about what kind of arguments are coming up, of what kind of theories come up here in this group of the people who are making fundamental decisions about Wikipedia. What the consequences of this or that action are, about the experiences that you already have when something went wrong, when something suddenly went pear-shaped, you cut off like a whole university, they never came back and they never posted anything, whatever happened, this is all very interesting to find out. And also, like, these whole questions, like, there is like, maybe there is a situation where one editor really has extremely good reasons to say, like, hey, this guy now should be made public in a normal, very, very good reasons. On the other hand, you will then destroy a safety for many, many other people who are operating on the promise that this will never happen. So these kind of, like, very ambivalent, complicated decisions, the arguments around it, your experiences around it, this is kind of like the intelligence that we want to dig out, and dig it out from many places. And we hope that when we dig out the intelligence on anonymity, that has been kind of like accumulated here in Wikipedia, and we put it together with the intelligence that has been accumulated by people who are in fragile positions while police, police is raiding them, and putting that into the, and so on. And then something very interesting, patterns will come up, which we then can mirror back, which we might be like something that we can give back to all the communities once we've done all the work.
Yeah, and I was just wondering if I could just ask a little detail also related to both of you guys. What you're saying is, do you know why, what reason, why would someone want to reveal who the editor is? Can you give me some scenarios? Like, why would someone do that? Because I would always fight for, I think I would fight, just maybe you guys would as well, just to keep them pseudonymous or faceless, nameless, keep them, right? So they're trolls, that's what they're saying. Well, there's trolls, and okay, is that the... So this person's, okay, all right.
There's also in some cases paid editing.
Paid editing, right. Okay. Yeah, personal prompts, okay. Okay. But isn't there a technical solution that, I mean, I'm not technical, but to make some sort of, as I mentioned like earlier, that someone talked about these proof of work tokens or something, isn't there a technical way that someone can stay nameless, but then also not be, paid editor or someone, or bot, or a spammer? I don't know how it works. You see what I mean? Like, it's just a person who's worked on this, has a token, and it's a, you know? There's a project in Wikimedia, sorry. So there's a project, there's an ongoing project in Wikimedia that does care about that, okay?
There's an ongoing project that does care about exactly those users, and it's called Snuggle.
Snuggle?
Yep.
That's cozy. That's really nice. Snuggle. No, but that's these are also, what I would also answer is back to what we were talking about, that each platform is not like a total solution of how we solve this problem generally on the internet and generally on the web. It's each individual website or community has to solve it for themselves. And it seems like you guys are really doing an interesting job of it. And you were definitely thinking through it, which is not, I think, definitely in the minority, unfortunately.
That quote you had from Lessig about how it should be only a little more work, right, I think is somewhat, struck me as somewhat naive, in part because the solutions, as you correctly identify, many of the solutions have to be very specific to particular spaces, right? Yeah. The Snuggle does help us address certain kinds of these spam problems in a reasonably privacy respecting kind of way, but it's a solution that would only work for us, right?
Right,
it is not a solution that's scalable, and similarly, what's going to work for Twitter trolls is not going to work for us, right? Mm. Like there's whereas the solutions to break anonymity for advertising work for everybody.
Yeah.
And so I think that's a fundamental imbalance that drives part of the problem here.
Totally, definitely agree.
So I also want to mention that we do have also demands from users to have more anonymity in Wikipedia. Like one thing is to be editing in San Francisco about Star Trek civilizations or in Luneburg about French cheese. Another thing is to be in other parts of a planet trying to explain things that are happening and document them that maybe your government or your company or your someone around you with a good handle on the police can have. And they are going to be very interested to know who exactly wrote that. And they are not going to even go easy on, maybe, well, sorry, it wasn't you, it was your neighbor, but anyway, I have you now. So in those circumstances, we have requests of more protection so people can just edit freely next to this anonymity.
Can I ask a question for some of the, like, Haitham or some of the folks who have been around a long time? I've always assumed that that use case, the sort of government privacy speech issue, was the driving reason why we never allowed why we allowed anonymous editing in the first place. Is that actually the historical reason there, or is it more just we didn't want to bother to implement logins, or do we know? Well, you or somebody else who's been around for a long time.
A veteran.
Actually, my answer was about to link to a question I was about to ask, as we have an anthropologist here. Why do we have anonymity in the first place? How did it start? So, right, when I think about it, right, it could be for many reasons, like that man in a cape, you know, Robin Hood, or for just to come, he has some sort of issues in his background, like to do some good. But he doesn't want to know the public to know more about him, right? I assume the largest reason when it comes to Wikipedia that it goes back, like bullies, right? In school, when they know something about you that you don't want to share, they just start bullying you for a reason. So we see that a lot within our Wikipedia teams. I would say the reasons that go back to, like, you know, larger security or goes back to governments, etc., that would be a minimum portion of it, a larger portion, just like. But yeah, my question really stands. If you could talk a little bit about the history of anonymity, that would be great. If you're interested about that.
Yeah.
Like the history of the last 5,000 years of anonymity. Okay.
Lecture two begins.
I would reverse my question. If we hypothetically assume that we know everything about everyone in the world, would there be any need for anonymity status?
On the danger, I think that, like, here I'm in open territory because I'm not an anonymity historian,
yeah,
but I believe that anonymity has been a fundamental cultural technique for getting many, many things, making many, many things possible. Say voting, cut off the name from your, you know, like really fundamental techniques in our democracy. And we kind of like didn't notice that they were, that the point of that was anonymity. We notice that only now as it is coming under threat. And I think the three big threats are, it's a strong discourse of transparency that is new, that is not, hasn't been such a strong idea only 30 years ago. It's ICT, which I have deeply, I mean, like they are non-anonymous, they are for sure, like at the beginning, non-anonymous forms of media. And they have to always artificially be anonymized. I mean, look at what an immense amount of work it took in the 50s to make money transfer possible on the web. Later, but you know what I mean. Mm-hmm. And that's actually 90s. So see my history. So what we are in a situation is that we all are becoming almost like anonymity scientists and specialists, and we haven't really fully noticed. And once we notice that, how much we are actually anonymity, how much we are increasingly, hopefully, because we need to become anonymity intelligent, we can bootstrap this process further. I think that's our agenda, that this is needed. So I think technological fixes, like we just discussed, are an important part of this mix, but I'm just as much interested in the intelligence that is accumulated here in how to treat these problems and how to like find these problems. That is actually, to me, almost more important than the actual fix. And this anonymity science that is developing without being called science, that's what we want to kind of bring to the fore and make public and then support. Yeah?
You just have to like press it.
Okay, how's that? All right, so I'm kind of thinking out loud here, so I reserve the right to disagree with myself in the future. But I was thinking about what Greg was saying about the incentives. And I see another incentive emerging kind of in the big data space, which is a managerial class who doesn't have the expertise to make decisions without numbers in an Excel sheet or data or unique user IDs or whatever, because they're not really close to the problem. Their experts are, but they need to have some purview into what's going on. And so they ask for a call for big data, right? It's like, but it's incentivized by a managerial class not understanding the nature of the problems or trusting the experts involved for judgment. So data in some but not all instances seems to be replacing good judgment. Does that make sense? But there's a massive push that, and I don't want to come out sounding like I'm against data or big data or any of that, but there's a, yeah, I'm repeating myself now. There's just an onslaught from the managerial class to get numbers.
Exactly, and I think that what you also mentioned, I saw this in the field of an analyst who just simply, he said he was very liberal, he considers himself a hippie, he had a different stance before coming to work and being an analyst and saying, well, they tell me that this is my job to collect more, to know more, to build a new feature. And this was also worrying that this, as you said, this top-down, let's create something new because we need more features and here's more data to create it, that's really worrying, right? He just said, well, I don't know what to, I have to do my job, right? I like my work. It's cushy. Let's stick around and do this. So the more, I'm wondering how many people have that situation too, right? So, yeah, you had that situation too, yeah.
And
we have 5 more minutes.
I totally agree with you that the data economy is another one of the forces that brings this problem and the need for a science of anonymity to the fore, because I think we think privacy doesn't cut it. It needs to be something about anonymity. But or should I say it, in Germany is a whole nation that's obsessed in Facebook bashing. They all use it, but they bash it endlessly. And that, like, the good thing about 3 years of ethnographic research is also that you can question some of this. I mean, like, Facebook is always painted as the big bad guy, and I think in many ways, you know, there are very, very problematic discourses put to the fore, and the whole clear name policy and so on. But it's very interesting once you talk to people with Facebook. They have very interesting and more subtle stances than you would expect. And so this is also, ethnography is like listening and not prejudging too much of what is right here. Like, maybe there is more interesting forms of anonymity science inside Facebook that we don't understand yet to be found. But open questions again.
Yeah. Cool. Does anyone have any? Does anyone have any other questions? If not, maybe I'll just, or does anyone online or on the chat have another question? Not really? Okay, just putting up for the reading, there's also a book by Finn Brunden and Helen Nissenbaum, which just came out, that also talks about these types of tools for privacy protection, but also addresses a bit about anonymity. And feel free to contact us, especially check back on this site, reconfiguringanonymity.net, which is the website for this larger project, and we'll have updates on there all the time. Or if you're ever in Hamburg or in Luneburg, just give us a shout. We're always welcoming. And thank you for welcoming us so much. It was really wonderful to be here. Thank you. Thank you.